What a great honor it is to be here with all of you wonderful, wonderful people. I just feel right at home. You know, at the Dream Center, we in Los Angeles, how many are acquainted with the Dream Center? Raise your hand. Well, it's quite a place. The Dream Center has, just about every nationality in the world that is there. I mean, we have everything at the Dream Center. We have drug addicts. We have prostitutes. We have drug addicts. We have alcoholics. We have gang members. And that's just the pastoral staff right there. Amen. We really got quite a group of people. I feel right at home. And let me tell you why I feel at home. My uncle was a missionary to India way back in the 30s and the 40s. Matter of fact, he was a missionary there for 21 years, and his name was Ted Vassar. He headed up the orphanage in Junior right outside of Pune. And I love India. I've been there many, many times, at least maybe 12 times that I've been to India. I learned that my uncle, I have two cousins that are buried in India because that missionary had two children. One of them, they couldn't get to the hospital. That was years ago, and they died when his appendix ruptured. And my little cousin, she died at birth. So I've got a lot of heart in India. I love your country so very, very, very much. I don't know, many of you know that I am Joyce Meyer. I'm her pastor. We ordained her at our church in Phoenix. And recently she asked me to go with her to Bangalore, India. And we had a crusade of over 400,000 people a night. She spoke two times, I spoke once. And it was one of the great experiences of her life. And then about 2 years later, went back with her to Calcutta, and we had a wonderful meeting outdoor there. So, how many of you know that I am part Indian? Raise your hand real high. Now, when it comes to curry and rice, we have eaten curry and rice twice at least a week at our home. We make it ourselves, and we get our curry powder grounded at a compound in India. So, I'm more Indian than you. Amen. I'll guarantee you, I eat my curry hotter than you eat your curry. I love it very much. I was disappointed when he told me tonight they were not having curry. I almost turned around and went back home. That's the only reason that I came, because I wanted to curry and rice. Amen. But it's great to be here tonight. And I think you all realize that I feel right at home being with you people. Now give me your undivided attention for just a minute. Forgive me if I'm just a little sentimental. Because a week ago, I turned 76 years of age. Excuse me. 79. What am I talking about? 79 years of age. I've been preaching now for 63 years. 63 years. I started at the age of 16 years of age. I've been married to the same lady for 53 years. I preached over 18,000 messages in my lifetime. I have traveled all over the world. Matter of fact, on American Airlines alone, I have 18 million miles just on American Airlines. And I said all that to say this: God has been so good, and I've been a blessed man so very, very much. Now, when I go out to preach, wherever I go, there's a prayer that I pray before I get on the airplane, and here's the prayer. Dear God, I don't know how many will be there. There could be 400,000, like when we spoke with Joyce Meyer. There could be 100 people, but that's not what is important. You see, I give it all I got for one reason. When I go out to speak, I'm looking for the one person that is in that house. That one person that is a miracle. Several years ago, I was invited to preach at the National Black Pastors Conference in Washington, D.C. Now, I had many outstanding speakers, but of all the speakers, I was the only Caucasian on the program. The rest of them were the great black preachers. And I said to the monitor, why in the world did you invite me? Everybody knows that these black preachers are the greatest preachers in the world. You have just set me up for failure. I feel like a pygmy among all these young preachers. Why did you invite me? Well, he said, Pastor, we invited you because you have a black heart. Amen. So that night I gave it all that I had because I was in very fast company. Little did I realize, sitting in that audience was a young preacher who was about to quit the ministry. His church ran less than 100 people. He had struggled. And he said, God, when I go to that conference, if you don't bless me and help me, I don't think I could go on anymore. That night I preached the message that I'm going to preach here tonight. It's my life message. He was so fired up. The message was entitled, The Miracle in the House. In the sermon, I say, everything that we need to build a great church is right here in this house. Everything that you need to reach your city is right here. The think tank, the creativity, the seed for the money is right here in this house. He later told me he got so excited, he thought he was going to have a heart attack. And he said, God, if you'll just get me out here alive, I want to be the miracle that is in this house. He went back and began to preach to his old church, and it began to grow. Soon it was running over 1,000 people. He was asked to preach on television, and he stirred the nation when he preached. Several years later, he invited me to be the speaker at his first pastor's conference. Introducing me that night, he told that story. And he said, I decided if I ever had my own conference, Pastor Barnett would be my first night speaker. He had over 8,000 pastors. You might have heard of him. His name was T.D. Jakes. Sitting right there in that service, there was a miracle that was in the house. And that's why old preachers have a hard time stopping preaching. You know why? Because they're not sure. The next service they preach, the miracle might be in the house. The very person that God put them on the earth to reach would be in that service. And so tonight, I want to talk to you about the miracle that is in this house. Holy Spirit, unless you anoint this message, it will be a tingling cymbal. But I pray, God, that you will take my mind, and you will take my lips, and you will take my spirit. I do not ask for the privilege of preaching a great message, but I have a great truth, Lord, and I pray that that truth will come forth tonight. Lord, you know I'm on an expedition tonight, looking for the miracle that is in this house. It could be a young person. It could be an older person. It could be a man. It could be a woman. But tonight, Lord, I'm here looking for that one that is a miracle in the house. I ask for your anointing in Jesus' name. Amen. In 1 Kings chapter 4 is a story that I'd like to tell you about tonight. In the interest of time, let me just paraphrase that story that we all know so well. There's a famine in the land. People are starving. They're dying. When suddenly a little lady who is about to lose everything realizes that she's going to perish. She only has a little bit of oil and a little bit of meal. And she has just a few sons, and even now the creditors are coming to take her sons. She looks at her cupboard and it's bare. And she realizes that she needs a miracle. It was in that moment that the man of God came into her life. And he asked her a question. He said, what have you got in your house? Now, friends, be very careful how you answer that question. For the Bible says, he that saith he hath nothing, the little that he has shall be taken and given unto another. Her answer was, I have nothing in the house. Now, folks, let me remind you that there's always something in the house. When I was a kid and I needed some money, I always found something in the house that I could sell. Some old bottles or some old newspapers. You see, there's always something in the house. Here was her response. She said, I have nothing. But then she said, except. She was saved by the word, except. I just have a little oil. Now, folks, sometimes we look at the dream that God has given us. If it's a God-given dream, it's bigger than us. And we look at our resources that we have to reach the dream that God has put in our heart. Because if it's God's dream, it'll be bigger than us. And we say, I have nothing in the house. But the Bible says, do not despise the day of small things. Amen. You see, the mighty avalanche begin with a little snowman. The mighty, mighty oak tree begin with just a little acorn. The mighty Christ begin with a babe in the manger. And when God gets ready to do something great, He starts with a miracle that is in the house. I want to say that everything this church needs to reach this great area is right here in the house. The think tank, the people, the creativity, the volunteers, everything that you need is right here in the house. Oh, but we say, if I could just get this great worship leader to come, our church would grow and take off. Or if I could get this great pastor to come, if I could get this youth leader to come, our church would take off. But let me tell you, when God gets ready to do something great, He starts with what's in the house. I want to tell you, there is a miracle in this house tonight. There's a miracle that God wants to raise up and maybe do something great for the world. It is right here in this house. And then the prophet gives her the recipe to her situation. He said, the first thing I want you to do is I want you to go borrow. I want you to borrow vessels, empty vessels. Listen to me closely. And therein lies revival. Therein lies church growth. Therein lies the move of God that you want. Oftentimes, pastors say to me, when I preach to my church, they're bored. He said, they sit there half asleep. And I said to him, the problem is your congregation is full. They can't take anymore. They're full up to here. What you need is empty vessels. Don't get mad at your full Christians. But listen, friends, if God sends revival, it will happen with empty Christians. I remember in our church in Phoenix, Arizona, every Sunday night God laid upon my heart that our people would meet together. Our service would start at 7, but they would come to the church at 4 o'clock. We had 47 buses in our church that brought in thousands of people on the weekend. And so I said, I want you to fill every bus about a third fill. And I want you to go out on the streets. I want you to find people. We'll give you a little flyer and hand it to them and say, look, we're going to church tonight. And here's what's going to happen. We'll be back to pick you up about an hour from now. And they literally went all over town. At service time, they would fill the building with people from the street, unsaved people. And when we gave the altar call, it was nothing to have 100 or 200 people except Jesus Christ. You know why? Because there were empty vessels in the house of God. You see, we Pentecostals are good at getting the gospel and the Holy Spirit to us. But we're poor at getting it through us. Oh yeah, we have a lot of conferences on how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. But we need some conferences on how to be spilt when God puts the fire of the Holy Spirit. Listen, we got enough fire, we got enough power to run the city. But the thing is, we need to pour that into empty vessels. And he said, I want you to go out and find all the empty vessels you can. And then he said, after you get all the empty vessels that you possibly can. And by the way, what was he doing? He was working to positive expectations. And God always works through positive expectations. Several years ago when I went to my church in Phoenix, Arizona, many of you maybe do not know, but we are one of the five largest churches in America. And I say this to make a point of any denomination. Our building seats 6,500 people. And every week we reach out to lost people that need Jesus Christ. And I stood before the congregation, and the Holy Spirit moved upon me that day. And I said, I want you to give all the empty people that you can. When I went to that church, it was running 200 people. And we'd come from Iowa, and the first Sunday morning, there were over 600 people. I said, man, they came to see the new preacher, but they won't be back the next week. But the next week, there were 1,000 people. And the third week, there were 1,200. So we had an emergency board meeting. Our building was filled. And I said, we need a bigger building. And we discussed what size building. Well, the deacons wanted to build it to seat 10,000 people. I wanted to build it to seat 5,000. Because I had to pay for the dumb thing, you know. Amen. So we got in a very heated discussion. So I said, let's table this and pray about it for a month and come back. So during that month, one of the deacons came to the church that day, and I took him home with me for lunch. My wife was fixing us a sandwich when Pat Robertson was on television. And she had a little television screen there. We were watching. And you know, Pat Robertson kind of got that prophet look in his eyes. And he said, I believe I'm speaking prophetically. He said, there's a revival that's coming to America. And he said, it's going to fill every church. He said, your churches are too small, pastors. And then he got that prophet look in his eye. And he said, I believe I'm speaking to one pastor particularly. You are building your church too small. And the deacon said, that's you, pastor, that's you. That's you. So we compromised. And we built it to seat 6,500. But folks, we built it too small. You see, God works through positive expectation. Are you expecting God to do something? Do you believe that God is going to do something? How many believe that God will use you to do something? See, the miracle is in the house. And then he said, after you get all of these empty vessels together, I want you to go in and I want you to shut the door. I don't want you to take anybody in with you that you don't have a relationship with. And folks, when you share your dream with somebody, be careful not to share with people that you don't have a relationship with. Several years ago, when I first went to Davenport, Iowa, my first week, a little fellow from down the street who lived on my block said, Pastor, I'm going to share my vision with you. He came to the church. He was a former football player. And he said, Pastor, I have a dream. I dream that someday I will have an athletes conference where we bring the greatest athletes together and we will train them for the Olympics. And while we train them for the Olympics, I will disciple them. And if they don't know Christ, I'll lead them to Christ. He said, Pastor, that's my dream. To someday have a big complex where they can train. Now, I'll be honest with you. I thought to myself, this guy is the windiest guy I've ever seen. I don't believe that could ever happen, but I didn't say it. So what do you do when you don't believe the dream is going to come to pass? I just said, praise God, amen, praise God. Well, the fellow was faithful in church. And soon he had a little athletes conference every year. And then every year got bigger and bigger and bigger until almost 1,000 athletes were coming from all over America. And he was discipling them and they were being filled with the Holy Spirit. One day, a man in our town who owned the Phoebe Swim Club and track club gave him this facility. It was worth millions of, and he gave it to him. Well, he began to bring athletes from all over America to train while he discipled them. When the Sydney Olympics came to pass, we qualified 15 people from our club to go to the Olympics. And we won 5 golds, 6 silvers, and 4 bronze. That's more than most countries. Come on, say amen. You see, sitting right there in my church was an athlete that wasn't doing anything for God. I'm trying to tell you, only God knows the miracles that are in this place tonight. Now he said, when you get that vision, you go in and you shut out the naysayers. You shut out the doubt peddlers. You shut out people that say, we've never done it that way before. Shut out people that say, we can't afford it. Shut the door, because they are doubt peddlers and they're dream stealers. Shut the door behind you. Now listen closely to me. There are people in this building that have dreams. Your dream is so big that you don't tell people because you're afraid they'll put it down or they'll laugh at you. Listen closely to me. And some of you are saying, Pastor, I would give everything. I would give all my time and I'd give all my money and I'd be willing to die for this dream that God has put in my heart if I was sure it was God's dream. But I want to be sure it's God. How can I be sure that my dream is not a selfish dream, but it's God's dream? Let me give you 3 ways. Number one, you can be pretty sure the dream is God's dream if it's bigger than you. If it's so big, there's no way in the world you could pull it off unless God would help you and God would get the glory, because everybody would know that you're not hot enough to pull it off. It had to be God.
Yes.
Is your dream bigger than you?
Yes.
Is your dream so big that if it came to pass, there would be no doubt about it that it was God that caused the dream to come to pass? Everybody can dream big. But you let a man of God dream big, and people will say, well, let's pray that God will humble our pastor. Amen. He needs humility within his life. It's kind of amazing that Donald Trump can build high rises and big auditoriums, and we say, well, that's okay. That's him. Las Vegas recently built a casino that cost $2 billion. Well, that's okay, because that's a gambling casino. They can do it. Or what about the Dallas Cowboys? They can build a stadium that will see 1 billion people. And they say, well, that's okay, because that's the sports. They can do it. Or somebody makes a movie, Spielberg, that costs hundreds of millions of dollars. And we say, well, that's Hollywood. But you let a man of God get a dream that's humongous. And people say, let's pray that God will humble him. But let me tell you, the man who's going to reach in the pastor and the church that's going to reach the entrepreneurs, who's going to reach the movers and the shakers, are going to have a bigger dream than them. And we have the word of God that says he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. In other words, think the biggest dream you can think, and God said, I'll blow that away. Is your dream bigger than you?
Hallelujah.
So number one, you can be sure your dream is God's dream if it's bigger than you. But the second way you can be sure your dream is God's dream is if you can't let it go. You see, if this dream is God's dream, at first you have to hold tenaciously to it. People will try to steal it. Circumstances arise, and then the big one, delay comes. And we think that a delay is a denial. But the Bible says, though the vision tarries, it will come to pass if you faint not. But most people faint before the dream comes to pass. It has been said that if you keep a dream for 5 years, that dream will come to pass. But most people can't keep a dream for 5 years. Discouragement comes. The naysayers come. The lack of funds come. Delay comes. And we scratch the dream. But I'm going to encourage you. Look at me and listen. Do you know how long I had a dream for the dream center before it comes to pass? Well, let me explain the dream center. We bought an old Queen of Angels hospital. It is 16 stories high. It has 1,400 rooms in it. Today, 23 years later, when we started from scratch, there's 900 people that live in that place. Every problem in the world, from drug addicts to all kinds of addictions. I had that dream for over 40 years before it came to pass. One day, I drove down Los Angeles. I was holding a revival as a young man. I looked at the great building called Angelus Temple. If you're not acquainted with Angelus Temple, Amy McPherson, the greatest woman evangelist maybe ever. She was like the Billy Graham of her day. She built this building in the 20s during the Depression. She fed more than 1 million people every year during the Depression. She raised more money for war bonds than anybody in America. I drove by that church. And God spoke to me and said, someday you're going to pastor that church. I said, God, you really missed God on that one. Amen. You see, I'm Assemblies of God and they're four square. And we have no dealings one with another. Isn't that sad? Amen. But God spoke to me 40 years. Oh, by the way, today, my son and I are the pastors of Angelus Temple with its 4,000 seats. Today we have the Queen of Angels on the freeway. 900 people from all kinds of addictions live at that place. We had the dream for 40 years before it comes to pass. Now, the last one, you can be sure it's God's dream. If you'd be willing to give your life for that dream. Look at me just a minute. I am so obsessed by the dream that God has put in my heart that I would gladly laid down my life for that dream. And if it's God's dream for your life, you'd be willing to die and give every blood drop for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, one day when I drove by and saw Angelus Temple, God spoke to me and said, you're going to be there. Well, years went by. And one day a man came to my door, knocked on the door and said, can I talk to Pastor? Well, he was a superintendent of all the churches in Southern California. He walked in and said, I've seen your complex here and I'm embarrassed to ask you what I'm going to ask you. He said, I believe that God has called you to Los Angeles. He said, we have no money. We have nothing to offer except a big opportunity. How many of you hate those big opportunities? Amen. I feel like saying, get behind me, Satan. He said, I feel like you ought to leave here. And I have to realize the building there is worth over $100 million on 72 acres on the side of a mountain. And he's asking me to leave to go to L.A. He said, don't answer, just pray about it. I thought to myself, yeah, I'll pray about it, but it won't do any good. He said, would you at least make a trip over and see the area. See the little ghetto church that we'll give you. So I went over and saw it. When I saw the area, I thought, man, I don't want to do it. And for 5 years, he would call me and say, what do you think? Now, I'll be honest with you. God spoke to me 40 years before that time that someday you're going to be in LA. And when he said, this door is open to you, something leaped inside of me. But how do you leave a great vision that God has put in your heart and just pack up and leave? After much prayer, I called him and said, look, I'll be glad to spend 2 days a week over there and oversee the project and get someone to help me. And I will stay where I'm at in Phoenix, but I'll do that. He was excited about it. So I began to look for a pastor that would help me build that church. And they got all excited. I mean, I picked the best pastors and the best evangelists. And I'd bring them over and they would see it and then they'd say, I don't believe that God's calling me to this area. You see, it was a blinded area. It was a dangerous area. An area of drugs and gang violence. I couldn't get anybody that was interested. So one day a man in my church said, Pastor, you've got this sermon, you preach the miracle in the house. And you're so dumb that you cannot see the miracle is in your house. I said, what are you talking about? He said, your son. I said, oh, I know he's a great youth evangelist, but he's only 20 years of age. And he said, I've heard you preach, do not despise a man's youth. I just hated when they used my preaching against me. So I went to my son and I said, son, would you come and help me? He said, Dad, I'll drive your car. I'll be your youth guy. Anything you want me to do, God, I'll be glad to do it. So I took my boy to L.A. You have to realize we got this little ghetto church right in a rough area of L.A. And the church that he took, the pastor was over 80 years of age. I used to think that's old. That's young now. Amen. The congregation was all in their 80s. Most of them were Filipinos. Most of them didn't even speak English. And here Matthew is 20, speaking to a congregation of elderly people. I remember the day I told him goodbye. I can see the picture to this day, him standing in front of the church, waving goodbye in a dangerous ghetto. And suddenly it hit me. I've set that little boy up for failure. He doesn't know anything about cross-culture evangelism. He doesn't know anything about it, and neither do I. And I parked the car and I begin to weep. I probably will mark that boy the rest of his life because this is an impossible situation. I got on the plane and I flew back to Phoenix. It's an hour flight. And when I got back, the phone rang. It was Matthew. He said, Dad, you won't believe what happened. No sooner than you pulled out of the parking lot, I heard shots. I ran to the front of the building. And I see this 14-year-old boy sliding down the steps with blood pouring out of his chest. He died in my arms. He had been shot by drive-by gang. Dad, what shall I do? I said, son, I don't know. I've never been in a situation like this. That night he had his first service. He hadn't even had Sunday service yet. But it was a youth gathering. He had about 8 or 9 at the meeting. And he said, you know, this is what happened today. And he began to weep. He said, I don't know what to do, but we've got to do something. He said, my dad has always taught me, when you don't know what to do, take an offering. Amen. And he took an offering. And he got 30 some odd dollars. He walked across the street where that little boy lived, knocked on the door. The little Hispanic mother came to the door. And he said, I'm so sorry what happened to your son. I was there. I loved him. It's not much, but we got 30 some odd dollars to help you on your funeral. She began to weep, and she said, come in, Padre. You'd never been called Padre before, but he went inside. The place was filled with gang members, and they would go to her and say, we're so sorry that your son was killed. And she would curse them and slap them and say, you got him killed. You got him killed in that gang. Tension was very high. And Matthew said he felt led to leave. When he got to the door and put his hand on the door handle, suddenly a big old hand grabbed him and spun him around. He's now looking in the face of the meanest gang member he's ever met. Matthew said, "Dad, I felt like saying, 'Lord, I'm coming home.'" The gang member looked at me and said, "Padre, before you leave, would you just pray for us?" And he gathered in the front room and they joined hands in a circle with a gang member. And Matthew began to pray. And he prayed a little cute prayer like, you know, "Lord, bless the birds and the bees and the trees and the coconut," you know. And the Holy Spirit said, "Quit being a wimp. Pray like you mean it." And suddenly he kicked in the second gear. He thought, "If I'm going to die, I'm going to go out in Fox Book of Martyrs." Amen. He said, "God, I come against the evil forces of darkness. I rebuke the devil in the name of Jesus and set these boys free." And then he prayed. He said as he prayed, he felt each one on each side that had his hand begin to squeeze his hand. He thought, "They're going to kill me." So he just kept praying a long prayer. And when he finished, they took his hands and they raised him up like this, a sign that he is one of us. And Matthew led them all to Jesus Christ in that room. Now he's excited. He called him and said, "Dad, you and I don't understand cross-culture evangelism, but I learned something tonight. I learned that you can't fight love. And I'm going to love these people like they've never been loved before." He said, "I'm going to make their culture my culture. I'm going to make their sport, which was soccer, my sport. I'm going to make their food my food. I'm going to make their holidays my holidays. I'm going to put myself in their world. And my children will go to their school." And he said, "Dad, I'm going to love this group of people. So Thanksgiving is coming. And I want to give everybody in the neighborhood a turkey. I need 3,000 turkeys. Dad, would you go to your church and ask them all to bring a turkey and bring it over here?" So I went to my turkeys. I went to my church. I told them the need. And they brought in over 3,000 turkeys. And we put them on a truck and we shipped them over there. But before the Sunday came, Matthew calls him, "Dad, I got a problem. I found out that these Hispanic people, they don't like turkey. They like chicken." I said, "Well, just tell them these are chickens on steroids." Amen. And Matthew called back and he said, "Dad, it's working. They love these turkeys." He said, "Christmas is coming. Dad, I want to give everybody in the neighborhood a present. I need 10,000 presents." So I went to my church. Isn't it great to have a dad with a big church? Amen. And I told them the need, and they started bringing in presents. One man, you're not going to believe this, bought 5,000 brand new bicycles. And we begin to give bicycles to all the kids in the neighborhood. Revival broke in that neighborhood. I would go over and preach, and it would be nothing to have 200 or 300 people saved. Now, I tell you, it was the roughest crowd I ever seen in my life. The Bible said, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature." Boy, do we have creatures in L.A., amen. I've never seen so much leather in my life. I've never seen so many earrings. They had them here, and here, and here, and here, and here, and here, and here. Only God knows where they had him. I didn't ask him. You talk about preachers. One day, the ushers ran up to Matthew and said, "Matthew, there's a guy here that says he's Jesus Christ." Oh, Matthew said, "Bring him. I want to meet him." Amen. So he came down the aisle in a flowing white robe. He had long hair, a beard, and it was white and flowing. Matthew said, "I'm pleased to meet you. I'm Matthew Barnett. What's your name?" He said, "Jesus Christ of Nazareth." Well, Matthew said, "Man, I'm pleased to meet you." He said, "Did you ever see the movie, The Passion of the Christ?" Oh, he said, "No, It brought back too many bad memories. Amen. You talk about creatures, we got creatures in L.A. Amen. And so we begin to reach out to those creatures. We give an altar call. And it was nothing to have 100 or 200 people get saved. But we couldn't keep them. And finally we realized that not only did they get saved, but we had to have a place to disciple them. We had to get them away from the gangs, from the drug peddlers, from the pimps. We had to get away from that environment. So the church owned 16 houses that bought up over the year. They were ready now. So one by one, we got the renters out. And every time they get saved, we put a room mother or father in the house to overlook it. And we begin to fill them. And soon, all 16 houses were filled. Matthew said, we got to get a bigger place, Dad. So one day he called me and said, I found it. It's a hospital. It's 16 stories high. It's vacant. And Dad, they only want $16 million. When he said that, I felt like Red Fox. I thought I was going to have the heart attack right there, you know. He said, would you at least look at it? So the real estate lady took us in. As I went through it, she said, isn't this a beautiful place? And it was a magnificent place. Finally, she said, what do you think? Would you like to buy it? I said, yeah, but it's not in our budget. And our budget was zero is what our budget was. So I had a little strategy. I thought, I'll make her an offer. She wants $16 million. I'll make it so low that she'll turn it down. And then I won't look like I don't have any faith in front of my son. Amen. So I said, yes, I'll give you $3.9 million. And she said, I'll take it. And then I thought I really was going to have the money. Because I didn't have any money whatsoever. Amen. But I said, tell you what, if you'll let us move in, we'll give you $500,000 down, which I didn't have. And I said, if you'll let us move in a year and a half, we'll give you the remaining, $3.4 million. And she agreed. Now, folks, we didn't know what we were going to do, but I got on television, and I said, if anybody knows how to reach the inner city, would you please come and see us? And a little fellow showed up. He said, Pastor, for 19 years, I've been going out, and I've been finding kids that have come to be movie stars. And they're here about 2 weeks, and they run out of money. They have no place to live. And he said, I find them. I find them sometime under the bridge, or I find them in burnout houses or living in trash cans. And he said, I tell them the good news of Jesus and they gladly accept Christ, but I have no place to take them. I take them to my garage, but my wife is about to leave me because our garage is filled with people. And I said, silver and gold have I none. But I got 16 floors, amen. And I gave him a floor. And he started bringing these little kids. And they started getting saved, and their life changed, and their habits just evaporated. And they began to go out and win souls to Jesus Christ. When another man showed up, he said, Pastor, for 14 years, I go out every Friday night at midnight. And every Friday night at midnight now, there are 60 people who go out with him. How would you like to start your ministry at midnight? And they go up to about 3 or 4 in the morning, armed only with an arm full of red roses. And they find these little girls sold in slavery on the street. 13, 14 years of age. Sold by their human trafficker. And they're depressed. They've been used by evil men all night. And we walk up and give them a rose and say, you're as beautiful as this rose. And by the way, this rose represents the rose of Sharon. And then we tell them the old story of Jesus who gave his life for them and how he loves them and he wants to set them free. And they begin to weep. And almost all of them accept Jesus Christ. And then we say, would you like to get away from this life? Oh, yes. Well, there's a place that we can take you. And they'll give you housing. They'll give you free food. They'll give you training. You can get your GED. They'll protect you. And it won't cost you a thing. Would you like to go? And her little eyes light up and she says, oh, yes, yes. And we say, okay, come on, let's go. And suddenly she snaps to reality and says, as fear comes in her eyes, my people over there will kill you and you'll kill me. I can't do it. And we say to that little girl, if you mean business, if you'll stand right here on this corner, we'll go get our van and we'll drive by and we'll slow down and slide the door open and you jump inside and we'll rescue you. 15 minutes later, we drive by, and sure enough, and we slow down. And the little girl jumps in the car. The pimp sees it, and he runs and jumps in his car. And the race is on to the dream center. But what that old pimp does not know is we call ahead to the dream center. And the dream center has about 200 men in discipleship. Most of them have come out of prison. And most of them are just barely saved. Come on, say a good amen. And we call ahead and tell them to be out in front. And when we pull up, there they are. With their tattoos gleaming in the sunlight in the muscles. And that old pump takes off and we never see him again. Come on, say a good amen. Listen, folks. Sometimes you just got to go gangster for God. Come on, say a good amen. And those little floors begin to fill up. And today we have one floor for human traffickers, another for discipleship, another one for homeless families. Most of them are women with children. Men have deserted them and left them on the street in cars. We have a floor for AIDS, people dying with AIDS. 15 floors. Of the outcast that nobody wants. The lepers of the American culture. Reaching them for the glory of the Lord. But now you've got to realize that I told them that we'd come up with the money in a year and a half. And now we are 2 months away from the deadline. And our agreement was that if we didn't have all the money, it would go back to them. And we'd lose all of our money. We were $2 million short in 2 months. I didn't know what we were going to do. I didn't want to tell anybody. When one day there was a man in my church in Phoenix who was the only man in that church that was against me going to L.A. He said, the reason why is I love Pastor Barnett too much. He's got his hands full of this big church here. He can't handle anymore. So I never ever talked to him about the Dream Center. One day he said to me, I want to go over and see that place. Now the truth is, I really didn't even want his old negative spirit over there. But he was a good giver, and I can be bought. Come on, say good amen. So I took him with me. I gave him a tour that day. And this wealthy businessman began to weep. I took him back to his hotel and said, I'll be back to pick you up for church tonight. He called me that afternoon and said, could you come early and have a bowl of soup? I want to talk to you. And I sat down. And as we're eating the bowl of soup, he began to weep and said, I've never seen anything like this in my life. And he wrote me out a check for $1 million. And he said, I just called my son and he would like to meet with you next week. Do you think you could work it out? I said, how about tomorrow? Amen. And the next week when I sat down, he gave me the second check. And neither one of them knew that I needed $2 million. Now look at me just a minute. There was a man who came to our church just before that. He was from Argentina. He said he had the multiplication anointing. He preached to an interpreter that night at the Dream Center. Here's what he said. My church didn't have anybody in it. I started it 8 years ago. And today I have 265,000 people in my church. Matthew nudged me on the front row and said, Dad, I believe he does have the multiplication anointing. He says, Pastor, would you like to have the multiplication anointing? Matthew and I said, yes. Well, come on the platform. So we came on the platform. He said, hold your hands out. And we did. And he reached into his pocket and he took a handful of mustard seed. And he let them sift into our hands. And he said, this represents multiplication. And he put his hands upon our head and he breathed into us and said, receive the multiplication of the Lord. It was shortly after that that these two men gave me $1 million. Now look at me and listen. Since that day, I've had over 25 people to give me $1 million or more for the Dream Center and the work of God. And by the way, all this money had come through my hands and none of it stuck. And today, the Dream Center is completely finished. It costs $49 million to buy it and bring it into code so we can have church. And it's completely finished. Debt free. Come on, give the Lord a good clap. It's called the multiplication anointing. So look at it. I'm about done. There are people in this building that need the multiplication anointing. You need it in your business. You want to be a conduit where the gospel comes to you and through you. There are people in this building that God has called to do a work for the glory of God. Maybe the next Billy Graham is here today. Maybe the next Mother Teresa, the Christian Mother Teresa, to do something for the glory of God. But you need the multiplication anointing. Don't you believe that God is no respecter person? Don't you believe that God loves an Indian in Dallas, Texas, as he does a little old pastor in Phoenix, Arizona? If God can do it for a Dr. Cho, a little boy with tuberculosis with no education that he healed and raised up, God would like to do it for someone from India here tonight. I believe there's a miracle in this house. And I'm going to do something I've done all over America, as I promise. I'm going to ask not one person to leave, but I'm going to ask everyone in this building, he'll say, Pastor, I need the multiplication of money. I got this dream that's bigger than me. I've got this vision from the Lord that's bigger than me. Pastor Barnett, I want that multiplication anointing. I'm going to pray for you. I can tell you stories all night of people that were in that crowd that night. And God did something supernatural in their lives. And so I'm going to ask everyone, with no one leaving, I'll dismiss you in about 5 or 10 minutes. But I want everyone in this building to say, Pastor Barnett, I want that multiplication anointing. I want you to stand up and come to the front of this building. And I'm going to pray for you right now. I need it in my business, Pastor. I need it in my family. I need it in my church. Pastor, would you just pray that God would send that multiplication anointing on me for the work of the Lord Jesus Christ? The Spirit of God is here. The anointing that breaks the yoke is here. Look at me just a minute. Now here's how we're going to pray. In just a minute. And thank you for holding with me without anybody moving from the audience. But here's what we're going to do. In just a bit, I'm going to pray for you. And as I pray for you, I'm going to ask you to just close your eyes. And while I pray, I don't want you to, some of you will want to cry, or you'll want to praise God, or you'll want to laugh or something because the Spirit of God is here in such a great way. But I want you, in your mind, to see. I want you to see the glory of God in your life. The Bible said if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. I want you to see that vision that you have. I want you to see it if it's already fulfilled. I want you to see that son or daughter coming home free from drugs, free from addiction. I want you to see that daughter coming home pure. I want you to see that marriage the way that you believe that it should be. I want you to see that business thriving. I want you to see that church that God wants to give you, that new building. I want you to see the altars filled with people coming to Jesus Christ. So while I pray, I want you to just see it in your mind. And you're quiet all that time. You're just seeing the glory of God. But at the end of my prayer, I'm going to say, now God, come down with your big bucket of anointing oil and pour it upon these people in the name of Jesus. And when I say Jesus, that's going to be the trigger word. You've been quiet all that time. But when I say in the name of Jesus, I want you to throw your hands up and I want you to cry out to God. And let's just have a little prayer meeting right here. Are you ready? Dear God, tonight I give them a message that if they'll receive it, it can change their life. I believe there's a miracle in this house. I believe, God, there's a great children's ministry here. I believe there's a youth ministry that's here. I believe, God, that the next Dream Center may be in this audience tonight. I believe that the next great church that you raise up, the next great organization like this one that is reaching the world, maybe that person is here tonight. So Holy Spirit, I pray that you will come down with your big bucket of anointing oil. Are you ready? And pour it on these people in the name of Jesus. Answered your prayer. Come on, thank you. something. There's a supernatural move. There's a miracle in this house. Why don't you say, I want to be that miracle, God? Come on. Say, God, I want to be that miracle. Yeah. God, I receive your miracle power. I receive that multiplication anointing. I claim it. It's mine and it's real. We worship you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Oh, somebody shout for joy. Amen. There were a lot of pastors there that night, but there were two people, my son and I, that said, it's ours, we take it. We're going to see multiplication in our lives. Now who's going to say, listen, but I'm just a small boy or girl, or just a young man or young lady. God's no respecter of person. If somebody would just believe him enough, he wants to. Now, before I turn it back to the pastor, when I'm asked to come and speak, they often say, Pastor, what would it take to get you to come and minister on ground? When they say that, usually I just turn them off and turn them away, because I've never put a price tag on the ministry and I never will. But 23 years ago, when we started the Dream Center, I've gone all over the world just preaching for churches. Sometimes they give us a lottery and sometimes they wouldn't. But 23 years ago, God said, I'll tell you what I want you to do. I want you to use your speaking engagements to keep the Dream Center going. You know how much it takes a month to keep the Dream Center going? You won't believe this, $900,000 a month. Know where it comes from. But for 23 years, I haven't taken a penny. Everything that's given tonight will go to the Dream Center. You'll say, well, Pastor, they probably pay you a salary. No, they don't. I'm rather bitter about that. Amen. Thank God. Just teach it. For 23 years, I've given all these speaking times to keep the Dream Center operating. But tonight, I want to tell you what it's going to go for. Tonight's offering is going to go. I said the building is paid for. But you know, I found out it's easier to pay for the building than it is to keep it operating. And one of the hardest ministries is the human trafficking ministry that we have. Joyce Meyer gave me $1 million to finish a floor for these girls, and we'll hold about 50 of these girls. But when they come in, they have to have medical attention. With their own diseased body. They have to have psychologists and counselors. They have to have security because each girl is worth $300,000 to their pimp a year. They're also, most of them, going to testify against these men in court. So we have to have 24-hour. If you go up to the 11th floor, you open the elevator, there's guards. Because the pimps will try to come in and steal them because they're a threat and a danger to them. It takes almost $400,000 a year. It's the most expensive ministry we have. That's why most people talk about human trafficking, but they're really not doing it. So be wary where you put your money. Because it takes a lot of money to do all these things, and these girls have special needs. Whatever you give tonight, we're about $41,000 short on our budget, or else we're going to have to cut it. It's the hardest ministry we have, believe it or not, to raise money for. Tonight, whatever you give is going to go to finish that budget. It'll be given towards that $41,000. I'm going to ask you to help me. I leave here and I go to speak at Birmingham for the great Chris Hodges Church. They run 40,000 people. Be there Sunday. Then I fly to New York, catch a plane, and I go to Siberia, Russia. Reach 2 nights and then to go to Moscow, 2 more nights, all these places, whatever comes in for me. People say, Pastor, you're going to kill yourself. look, I'm not going to die one day sooner than God wants me to. But let me tell you, you can make life a lot easier because I need your help. If you have a kid that's down to drugs and alcohol or any kind of addiction, you just call us and say, help us. Nobody pays at the Dream Center. No government help whatsoever. We'll take care of your child. If you can get your child there, we'll take care of it. This is your Dream Center, but you got to have us pay for it. Come on, say amen. Amen. You know what? The miracle may be in this house. If 41 people gave $1,000, now don't laugh. You shouted when I said there's a miracle in the house. Who knows? Some can give $1,000. Some can give $500. Most people can give $100. But I'm saying to you tonight, would you help us with the Dream Center? I sure love you all. And I thank you. I thank you, Lord. You know, sometime in the smallest settings, God does the biggest miracle. And that you look and say, but I just believe it. I'm going to pray for you, Lord. We want miracles, but often, Lord, we have to sow into somebody else's miracle before we get our miracle. And sometimes we have to sow into something bigger, and we get the draft effect that kind of pulls us along. Father, that miracle may be here, but it'll take a miracle sacrifice. Because when we do the unusual gift, then God does the extraordinary, or God does the miraculous. So tonight, many of them are sowing seeds into the poorest and the outcasts and the lepers spiritually in our society. And you said, God, when we give to the poor, that we lend to God, and He will repay. Now, Lord, I pray that You will speak to them what they should give. And Father, unless it demands something, unless God, it's big, it's probably not you. But I pray, God, would You speak that number that is bigger, realizing that when we do the unusual, we give the unusual. That's when You do the extraordinary in our life. We sow a seed into our need in Jesus' name. Now keep your head bowed. Lord, just speak to us now. Just keep your head bowed. I'm going to be quiet. And just let the Lord speak to you about what you should give. Standing up, can you? Amen. So go back to your seat right now. And I turn it to the pastor. He told me to take this offering like this tonight. And I thank God for a group of people that want to give to the work of God. Thank you so much, Pastor. Daniels, I love you so much. Tomorrow, the great ministry God's raised you up to do. And I know you have needs right here. But unselfishly, you gave an offering to the Dream Center. God's
going to
bless you.
Praise God. Glad to be here. Please don't go. We are going to do an important ministry. And the pastor told me about it. We appreciate your presence here.